Well, about several months ago, Kenny Jones, our youth pastor, said to me, "Hey, Jamie, would you do a co-teaching with one of the young men in our student ministry? I've been watching this guy. He fits the category of restoryteller. He'd been with us this year. We were like, hey, let's make the next year a year of restorytelling. So not just storytelling, but restorytelling. We made up the word. And the idea was there are stories out there, but beautiful stories are stories of people being restored and new life coming to stories. And so who are the people out there who are restorytellers? They're speaking life into the world by telling a new story or telling a story through the lens of redemption. And he said, you know, this guy fits this category. Him and his brother, they're doing a thing. I think that's pretty special. But I've heard him teach, and I think he has some insight for the word, and he's a good communicator. And I just think it'd be a good idea if you'd have him teach with you some Sunday. So I wrote it on a sticky note. I put it with my study material. And this is our last Sunday on 10,000 Minutes in this series. And last week we talked about loving God. This week we're talking about loving others. That maybe this is the right Sunday to have him join us. So would you please welcome to the stage, teaching with us today, my son, Jordan George. Son,
hello.
Welcome. Talk a little bit about what you do as a storyteller.
Yeah, so me and my brother have a band. We're called the George Twins, and our goal, our mission is to inspire people to know that they are loved through pop music. And so that's our goal, that's our mission, and it's a blast.
So you also serve in the church. I know you've been serving with a young adult ministry called The Farm. You guys run a retreat. Brett invited me to come speak this Tuesday. I'll be there.
Yeah.
For those who are young adults who go, hey, I'd love to come, what are some of the details?
Yeah, so if you're a young adult anywhere from 18 to 80, you can come. And
I love that.
It's a young adult gathering at The Cookery in Nashville. It's below. It's like the basement space. And it happens at 7 p.m. every Tuesday. So if you know Brett Mabry or you want to go to journeyfranklin.com/ministries, you can find details under The Farm there.
Yeah. Great. I'm looking forward to it because it's a different, it's kind of a question and answer thing, and it's going to be a lot of fun. You also serve with youth ministry. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so I lead a group of eighth grade boys that are super calm, super gentle, just very docile creatures. So I have a blast. I'm like their village leader. And so we have a blast every Wednesday night. Yeah, so that's what I do in the youth.
And several months ago, I don't know, probably been 6-8 months ago now, you were invited to go on a songwriters retreat.
Yeah.
And one of the songs that we'll be doing later on in the gathering became really, you wrote it with Sarah and with Harvest.
Yeah.
And it became really meaningful to you. And that really became why, that's the reason we've come to this passage.
Yeah.
This passage in many ways was an inspiration for this song. But talk a little bit about that and why this is the passage we're going to today.
Yeah, so I had the privilege to go on a songwriter's retreat, like you said, a couple months back, and actually wrote the song that you'll hear a little later today. Is the first worship song I was ever a part of writing. And so, like I said, I've always done pop music, and writing worship song, pop music, a little bit different. When we went to write this song, Sarah, one of the other writers, came with this passage that we're talking about today. And the whole song is based off this passage and blind Bartimaeus's interaction with Jesus. And so the story itself is just so powerful. And from the story, we wrote the song.
Great. Well, let's go to the passage. We're reading from Mark chapter 10. And I'll start reading in verse 46. Right before I do, I'll give you a quick little backdrop where we're picking up in the story. Jesus has been on the planet now for 33 years. He's been ministering for the last three. So he's been healing people. He's been challenging people. He's been teaching. He's been storytelling. And we're up to the very last week of his life. As a matter of fact, this is a pretty marked moment because they're leaving a city called Jericho. If you, some of you grew up in the church, maybe you remember a song called Joshua Fought the Battle of Jericho and the Walls Came Down. It's the same city, only it's lots of years later. So King Herod has rebuilt the city into an oasis, so think palm trees and...
Fort Lauderdale.
Think Fort Lauderdale. It's an oasis in the wilderness. It's a beautiful place. It's a resort town. They stop by this town, and then they head up a long, dusty road up into to kind of cold, mountainous Jerusalem. And it's feast time. So when you think of this story, think kind of a crowded road. Everybody's traveling. Things are happening. There are people on the side of the road, people who are begging, people who maybe lost their way. I'm just thinking kind of crowded, transitory experience. And then for Jesus, as he's walking up the road, also think in terms of he knows his mission. So this is going to be the last week of his life. He's going to be betrayed by those whom he loves. There's going to be falsely accused. He's going to be taken away in the middle of the night. He's going to be beaten. He's eventually going to be crucified. He's going to die. And he's going to come forth from the grave. He knows this is it. He was placed on the earth. This is to save the human soul. This is about the redemption of mankind. So think about what he's carrying as he's walking up this mountainous road heading toward Jerusalem. All right, so it's truly a journey in every meaning of that word. Verse 46, then they came to Jericho as Jesus and his disciples together with a large crowd were leaving the city. A blind man, Bartimaeus, that is son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, shut up. But he shouted all the more, "Son of David, Jesus, have mercy on me." Now, we'll pause right here because this was really interesting for us as we read this story. First of all, these two statements that Bartimaeus says are pretty significant. But the moment with the people who are, you know, like trying to get him to shut up.
Yeah,
be quiet.
We kind of, when we were studying, we kind of pictured this moment of there's this guy at the party or whatever, like hanging out, like, I don't know if you've ever experienced this at social gatherings or things, like someone who just doesn't understand social cues and just is yelling. And so, in a way, it kind of reminds me, like Bartimaeus reminds me of that guy. And it's like, okay, dude, like, I get it. You know, I need mercy. So it's this moment of like, they're saying, dude, be quiet. Shut up. Seriously.
Yeah, don't distract us.
Yeah, don't distract us. We're on our way to the feast. We want food. So, yeah.
Yeah, and he really seems to be a bit of a character. There's something about this guy. A lot of times Jesus interacts with people, and the people aren't named. This guy's given a name in this passage. And I don't know if it's because, you know, there's a legacy later on, but there's something about him that is really peculiar. Now, these two phrases are really significant. And what struck us in study was all of life hinges on these two phrases. His recognition of who Jesus was and then his recognition, his own self-awareness.
Yeah, so it was interesting. This is the second time I've ever spoke with my dad up on stage. And I used to think that what he would do on a Saturday is just like sit and wait for like divine inspiration to just come down. Like I thought as a pastor's kid, like not knowing, like I just thought like that's how it happens. Just like, and like not, maybe lightning wasn't involved, but like it's just this moment of like, bang, you have the message. And I was like, oh, so you, when we were sitting down, I was like, so you actually have to study. Like you have to like look at things and figure out where it goes. You don't just like get up and like start speaking.
About 6 hours in, he's like, are we done? Like when does this, how,
is this the moment yet? So when we came to the part that said son of David, this was a part that I really resonated with. And it was interesting to me because when he says son of David, he's actually speaking to Jesus as the Messiah. Because he have to have some kind of knowledge of scripture, of the Old Testament, and of the prophecies to point out and go, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And by calling him Son of David, he's in that moment saying, I know who you are, and you're the Messiah.
This was a pretty significant moment for you guys when you were writing this song.
Yeah.
This got real personal real quick. Yeah. That's such an interesting phrase. I know who you are.
Yeah, so in the song that you'll hear in the next worship set, there's a line in the song that we wrote saying, I know who you are. And this is where that line comes from. It comes from this line saying, Son of David. Because in this moment, he's going, I know who you are in this moment. And it's a beautiful moment of recognition. He's one of the very few people who actually figure out who Jesus is before he dies and resurrects. So,
and not only does he have this recognition of who Jesus is, but he has enough self-awareness. And that's why I say, well, this seems to be the basic element to understanding what it means to be a follower of Jesus, because he says, have mercy on me, which implies I'm powerless to change my circumstances. I am in need. Please help me. Have mercy. I'm not good enough. I need someone else to step into my life. And for those of us who have a propensity to be independent, to solve our own problems, to fix everything, it's really hard to ask for what you need. But there is a posture of humility about Bartimaeus that's really significant. Even the way he bypasses what other people say, that was meaningful to you, right? Because you said this year's been about, you've been thinking about perception.
Yeah, so I don't know if others of you are like this, but a lot of times I feel like there's words that kind of repeat throughout the year, and I don't know if I'd call it like my year word, but like I have like these words that kind of reoccur throughout the year, and so I've kind of focused on them, and the word that I've focused on this year is perception. And so when we went to this verse to talk about today, I was so struck by Bartimaeus' interaction with the people that rebuked him. Because I think deep down all of us, you know, I heard growing up, like, just don't care about their perception of you. Just, you know, block it out and tell a teacher or whatever. But I don't feel like that's a reality, because deep down we all care about how other people perceive us. But the thing that struck me was the fact that it wasn't that Bartimaeus didn't care about the people who were rebuking him, like their perception of him, but he cared more about Jesus' perception of him than the people rebuking him. And I think it's more about understanding God's perception of us and resting in that than it is trying to not care about others' perceptions of us. Because with my brother and I's band, it's like there's a business aspect of creating a brand and caring about, are people, you know, liking what we do? Are we doing everything? Are we optimizing what we're doing? And so a lot of times that perception of ourselves and like the business kind of goes back and forth, and it's such a fine line. And so something that I've had to really be self-aware of is, especially with my band, is am I caring way too much about the Instagram followers or, you know, how my band is doing, and caring about their perceptions of me instead of focusing on the only perception that truly matters, which is God's perception of us. So I think if we can rest in that, I think we'll be a lot better off in the long run.
Well, I'm going to say a word about my son. And we have several gatherings. I haven't said this in any other ones, but I want to say this to you. I watch him get up early in the morning, and he takes his Bible and he takes a journal and he goes outside into the woods. One time he came back with a great deal of poison ivy, as a matter of fact.
Don't take a machete that you got from Nicaragua and cut poison ivy down a path.
Up and down his legs, all over his arms.
Well, I didn't realize it was poison ivy. I didn't go to Boy Scouts or anything like that. So
he's,
I was
a musician,
just chopping away.
Yeah. But I'll tell you what, he gets up early in the morning and I watch him go spend time with God. And so he's not just saying they're not words. To do what he does in a world of perception, for those of you in the entertainment business, it's you can't run away from it. And we've talked about it. Like, can we just avoid social media? No, there's no way to do it. It's not, if you're going to do this thing in today's world, this is going to be part of your life. And so he's looked for ways to put spiritual disciplines in his life to counter that, to try and create balance. And I love what you just said, Jordan, about You know, sometimes there's something in our life we don't want it there and we try to resist it. But resisting it is giving it more energy. And rather than going, oh, I'm just so worried about people's perception, I'm not going to worry about it. You just keep thinking about how you're not going to worry about people's perceptions. And what you hear Jordan saying is, actually, what if you just shift your attention and instead of trying not to worry about it, actually just give your attention over to Jesus and go, you're enough. You're enough for me in this moment. And it seems that's what's happening with Bartimaeus. You feel this in the interaction. And this comes to verse 49. And for Jordan and I, it was our two favorite words in the entire passage. And for us, the whole passage hinges right here on this phrase. Bartimaeus is crying out, Son of David, you're the Messiah. I know you have the power to help me. Please, I'm powerless to change my circumstances. Have mercy on me. Verse 49, Jesus stopped. And of course, I was telling Jordan, when you get into the story, I want you to climb in the story. He said for
yeah.
you.
Yeah. So, one thing about my dad is that when we went into study, he was like, all right, so I want you, because it's not divine inspiration.
I hope there's some involved.
I mean, yes.
Please.
I mean, yes. But, yes. I don't want to discredit that. But there's study involved. And so, so he's like, just climb into the story. Like, imagine you're there. Like, imagine the dusty roads and in the sweaty sandals and the, you know, the long flowing hair and the robes. I'm like, okay, I'm there. I'm there. And so it's like, Jesus stopped. And so all of a sudden my brain went to this, like, Three Stooges moment where, like, they all, like, stack up and they're like, oh, and they stop. And it's just like, oh, wait, what's happening? Because, like, there's all these people going, so one person has to initiate. And I just thought of this moment where they're just, like, stacked up on each other. And so I pictured this moment of, like, I mean.
Jesus stopped.
Jesus was probably the first one.
And everybody else just crashed into him. I don't know that it happened like a Three Stooges moment. Like,
I think it did.
In Jordan's world. But regardless, the moment is great. Because Jesus does stop everything that's happening, and everyone else has to stop as well. And Jesus doesn't stop and say, hey, Bartimaeus, come here. Instead, he actually gets the people involved who are rebuking Bartimaeus. And he looks at them and he says, call them to me. So picture this. This is the same people with their preoccupation and prejudice. These are the same people who are saying, many rebuked him, told him to be quiet, told him to shut up. Now we're in verse 49. So they called to the blind man, hey, man, cheer up. Get on your feet. Jesus is calling you. Come on. I mean, he includes people when it comes to displaying his love. And I think the principle is important for us. Because as we go, while we are walking, while we are driving behind a slow person, as we are journeying, there's that person who's that annoying, or that person who has that energy about them, or that person who has whatever. Whatever that thing is for you that's difficult. And Jesus is saying, actually, you were rebuking them, or you were ignoring them. I actually want you to pay attention to them. Actually, you're the very person I want to call them to me. He uses us. Sometimes right smack in the middle of our preoccupation and prejudice. And so they do. And then verse 50, we're back to Bartimaeus and his response. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. That was an interesting phrase, throwing his cloak aside. So we dug into that a little bit.
Yeah. So reading one of the commentaries on this passage, the author talks about how by Bartimaeus throwing his cloak aside, it would have been probably one of, if not his only outer cloak. And so by throwing it aside, he's leaving it to be trampled on and ruined or stolen. And so by doing this, it just adds to this idea of his reckless abandonment of his security blanket in a way. And stepping into this moment and getting excited about, I think this guy can change me. I think this guy can do something radical in my life. And so by throwing this blanket to his side, he throws away his security.
We talk a lot about how we have a temptation to medicate, to place our security in something other than God. And there's, you know, a life principle is that we always have to give up to go up. There's always some kind of exchange for anything of value. And that seems to be wedged into this story on purpose. That when we are called to Jesus, there's usually something we're meant to give up. And it's usually the thing that we were counting on to keep us safe. An important principle that we feel like is wedged into this powerful story. He comes before Jesus, and of course you have this Jesus who just has this unbelievable ability to say so much with so few words. But here he is, he's before Jesus, this blind man who has some kind of spiritual insight is now standing before Jesus. Jesus looks into his eyes and says, "What do you want me to do for you?" Last week we talked about Revelation 3:20, the passage that talks about Jesus is standing at the door knocking, that there's a deep longing woven into our existence to remind us that we need God. If you didn't listen to last week, if you weren't here last week, go to our podcast or videocast, because it's really a setup for this week. But if you go to the door and you allow Jesus to come in, it seems like every time we throw up the door, you wake up in the morning, you rub your eyes, you go to your cup of coffee, or you're getting ready, and you say, "Good morning, Lord, and I welcome you into my day," that he's saying, "What do you want me to do for you today?" And there's this great reminder in this exchange that God has the ability to do something, and he's willing to do something. That's what's set in that phrase. The power to do something and the willingness to do something. And the question is just, do we have enough of a posture of humility to say, "Oh, thank you, this is what I need. Would you please do this?" Are we prepared to answer God when he asks that question? Because that question seems to always be before us. It's the persistent question from God. He wants to love us. He wants to give something to us. And of course, Bartimaeus, I mean, just right along with the rest of kind of his exchange, the blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." And Jesus said, "Go. Your faith has healed you." And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. When you hear him saying, "I want to see," certainly there's the physical aspect. I've carried around this disability with me for a long time. I'd like to be healed from it. And he is. But it's more than just this physical sight. And you know it because you see what he does. He doesn't run off. He doesn't go find his cloak and grab it. He doesn't head back toward Fort Lauderdale, as you say. He doesn't head back down the hill. No, he follows Jesus. If you have the moments where you're like, I just need God's will for my life. I'm looking for some new direction from God. And you ask him in response to the question when he says, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Oh, God, I just need you to give me my will, direction." And you feel like God tells you something and off you go. If you leave God behind, there's a pretty good chance that probably wasn't what he was telling you to do. For when he gives you something to do, the natural compulsion for you is to then follow him. That's what happens here in this passage. And you see with Bartimaeus this incredible expression of faith. He follows Jesus. Now the centerpiece for this whole thing is Jesus' willingness to pause, to stop, to see, to ask a question, and then to meet a need. And so the question Jordan and I were wrestling with is, well, what's our takeaway? We've been talking about this as a season of 10,000 minutes. 80 minutes are right here. We're talking about God's word, and we're hopefully listening to his spirit speak to our hearts. But we got 10,000 during the week. What do we do with this? How do we respond to people on the sides of the road in our lives? Those who feel powerless, those who are in need. And it seems to be wrapped around this idea of changing our pace. You said at the retreat you guys were on, there was a theme for the retreat that really impacted you. Talk a little bit about that.
So at the young adult retreat, the theme for the week, or the kind of saying that we kept throughout the week, was the enemy of depth is speed. And in our culture today, we don't, you know, it's not just fast food anymore. It's instant food. It's not just fast communication. It's instant communication. And so in a lot of ways, especially our generation as young adults, has been trained to have things instantly. And so when we don't have things instantly, we're thrown off because, well, the rest of the world functions this way, and we get all of these things instantly. And so the amazing thing that Jesus models in this is, in his pausing, is this idea that when we slow down, we're able to see other people's needs. I used an analogy when we were studying of if you're going 100 miles an hour in a car, which I hope that you're not probably. I mean, yeah. Don't go 100 miles an hour in a car unless you're like racing or something. An illegal place, not on the, you know, all so many clarifications. If you're going 100 miles an hour and you see an accident, you might not even recognize it as an accident. You might just see, oh, there's somebody pulled over on the side of the road, or two cars pulled over on the side of the road when you're going 100 miles an hour. And so you'd miss it. You'd miss seeing whatever is there. But if you're going 30, you can literally look as you go by, go, oh, wow, that car ran into that, the back of that car. Look at their front's messed up. And so you can start to piece together what happened and even how to help. And so I think that a lot of times when we're able to slow down and slow the pace, we're able to truly see people's needs and where they're at. And so it's impossible to speed by someone and go, or you might just have a shallow interaction with them as you pass by at 100 miles an hour, but at 30 miles an hour or completely stopped, you can see so many things that you would have never seen before. And so that's why I think stopping like Jesus does in this moment, even when he has all of this stuff on his mind, like one of the things that blew me away is like, he's going to die. He's going to complete the mission that he was sent here to do. Like the thing. So, and for me, I would totally be in my head walking down the road. It's like, okay, when's the moment going to happen? Like this, I know I have to do this. Like you said, he's about to be at the place where he's like sweating blood. So for him to be out of his head, living in his heart, and to be able to stop and see this person on the side of the road in their need is mind-blowing for me, because he has every right to go, well, I have a greater mission. Well, I have a better thing to do. I'm sure someone else will get to it, you know? And so the idea of stopping in this moment and helping him out, listening to someone's cry for mercy, man, I want to do that. I want to stop.
It's interesting because even you think about the Good Samaritan story, you think about so many of these stories that Jesus is telling. He's not only telling stories about it, he's modeling it. He's saying, you've captured that so well, Jordan. He's just saying, please slow down. See people. God can do something in our hearts for another when we create space to see him. And when we see him, we will see others. You had a moment where a friend of yours really experienced this in a deep way.
Yeah. So, if you know me at all, you know that I love video games. And I don't know how many of you love video games, but I do. And I feel like they bring people together and, you know, dads always encourage them, kind of, since, you know, because go outside, play. But anyway, video games are great.
He's invited me to play. I just get
he's not very
shot
good at Halo
most of the
or
time.
Really any other video game, but he's still experience. He's there, you know. He'll let me shoot him. That sounds so terrible.
It
I'm
really
sorry.
Does. Thanks, son.
Wow. On stage too, man. So anyway, I have a friend over and we're playing this game called Rocket League, which is soccer with cars, in case you're wondering. My favorite game. And we're just sitting there playing, and my friend Cole leans over to me and says, you know, you beat yourself up a lot, don't you? And I was like, oh, shoot. How did he see that? And I wanted to laugh it off at first because, you know, it was such a random comment, but I couldn't because it was so true. And for a moment, I just kind of sat there, and I was like, yeah. Yeah, I do. And it was so spectacular for me, for this guy to see past what I was trying to front, my trying to give him the perception that he should see. And he saw past it, and he saw all the shame that I put on myself and the ways that I beat myself up. And he just simply asked a question, you know, you beat yourself up a lot. And we ended up talking about it and really getting into our hearts about it, and it was so meaningful. But if he would have just left it at that question, we went back to playing games, it still would have been so meaningful. I felt seen, I felt loved, I felt known in that moment. And I think the reason he could do that is because he was slow enough to see that in me. He had slowed his pace down enough to see a need in my life that I don't need to beat myself up over the things that I've done or the things that I struggle with, but I am worthy of being loved. And that was so tough for me to hear, but it was a truth that I needed to hear. And so in that moment, you know, and something that I'm trying to lean into now is, how can I be slow enough to pay attention to the needs of others? And my friend Cole did such a good job at making me feel loved and making me feel known. Because as a pastor's kid, you know, you're called to do, and I'm sure there's probably PKs in the audience too, you're called to do so many random different things for the church that you're serving. It's like, oh, we need you to set up. We need you to tear down. We need you to do this. We need you to, like, set light candles. We need you to do the giving stations. Can you do this for me? It's like, yeah, sure. You know, you trust me, sort of, with things. And so there's all these ways in which, as pastor's kids, like, we give. And, like, it's just kind of implanted in us. And so rarely am I able to receive like Cole did to me and be poured in like he did. And so we were reading a quote. What was that quote from Soul
Larry
Talk?
Crabb. Yeah, he said, yeah. Good listeners are often lonely people. Because if you're actually a good listener, when people interact with you, they want you to listen. And so if you're a good listener, it's actually really hard to
be heard.
Yeah.
And so in that moment with Cole, it was just such validation and so good to be heard and seen in that moment. And so I think that was a beautiful example in my life of someone who's slowed down enough to see me.
So Jordan and I tried to look and go, so what could we summarize what Jesus has done in this passage and modeling this for us, and that there might be a takeaway for us during the week? Again, here's our 80 minutes. What about the 10,000? Is there something Jesus modeled? So if you're taking notes, great, continue, because I'm about to give you something. If you haven't been taking notes, pull out a journal or your phone or something. We're going to give you four lines. These are four summary things of what Jesus did, and it's just a super practical way for you to be aware of the needs of the people around you. So Jordan, give us that list.
Yeah, the first one is Jesus stopped. He listened. He clarified the need, and he met the need. So one more time, Jesus stops, he listens, he clarifies the need, and then he meets the need.
The clarifying, I think, is such an important element of this. So if you stop long enough, someone's in need, and maybe you don't know for sure. They're angry, or maybe they're sad, or maybe they're preoccupied, and you know, you interact with them, you just tell. Sometimes you might say, how are you? And someone goes, I'm all right. And I often say, what would take you from all right to really good?
I say that too.
Oh, maybe I got it from you, or maybe we're related.
No, I think I got it from you.
So Jordan and I say to people, what would take you from, and what we're doing is we're just trying to ask a little deeper question. So stop, listen, ask a clarifying question. Hey, is there anything that you need? Yeah, I need a break. I need a break for my kids. I need a break for my family. I need whatever the thing is. And maybe you go, well.
That's my favorite voice that you do.
You like that one?
The one that's like the different version of another person.
Thank you.
When you speak.
When I do that.
That's like Batman, kind of like, oh, yeah, you know, like, we need another reason.
Thanks.
It's like when we were kids, he used to read to us in different voices. And so, like, that's one of the voices.
I'm trying to wrap it up.
And he's trying to wrap it up. But it's so funny to me because he'll use these different voices that, like, when he switches in and out of characters. So anyway, that's one of my favorite.
I'll try to use that more often. Thank you.
Sorry, I took away from the divine moment that's supposed to happen right here.
This is where we wrap the whole thing.
Yeah.
Okay. You good now?
I'm good.
Okay.
Are you good?
I'm good. I'm focused. If someone's in need, take a moment, clarify the need, because that's the place where it can be real specific. And the final thing is meet the need. And if you can't quote meet the need, you go, I don't know if I can do that. Maybe you can resource them with someone who can, or you can resource them to God. So you might go, well, okay, maybe I can't do this, but I know that God has the power to do anything. And I have a relationship with him, and I just want you to know I'm going to be praying for you. I'm going to speak your name in the throne room of heaven. The God of the universe is going to be hearing about you today. Because I think you're significant enough. I think you're worth it for me to take some of my time and lift your name up. I just believe that something happens when you pray. And that might be the takeaway. Don't get too far ahead and like, I don't know if I can do this. Like, stop, listen, clarify, and meet the need, whether it's through a physical, emotional response, or simply by offering prayer to God. Jordan wrote this last line, and I just wanted to wrap it up with this. It's a great metaphor and a great picture, and I hope it summarizes our conversation today. Will we change our pace? Will we slow down enough to listen to the melody of someone else's life? Jesus stops long enough for an encounter that is life-changing. Will we do the same? Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for your stories. Thank you for recording these for us. Thank you for characters like Bartimaeus. Thank you for his passion and his perseverance and his willingness to speak boldly and the example that he sets for us in his pursuit of you. Jesus, thank you for the way you have modeled how to interact with people. Thank you for the way you include others. Thank you for the way you listen. God, I just, like, these are these moments I wish I could have been there. I would have loved to have watched you looking into the eyes of Bartimaeus. I would have loved to have seen the moment where he could see and imagine probably the worship experience that followed, as I'm sure he cheered and others sang and they considered who Jesus might really be. God, would we do the same? Would you not be some figurine on a table, not some abstract energy source, but that, God, in these moments we would remember who you really are. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. And God, would you empower us? Would you pour into us a deep compassion for people? That we would give this love away. And God, I ask, because you tell us to ask with boldness, I pray that the acts of kindness that will happen this week, and I'm confident they will, that some of those acts will spill into conversations, and in those conversations you will be proclaimed, that someone will literally be able to hear the great news of God's love, and that, God, that love would pour out over them, and that there would be those who would find salvation. God, I just ask with boldness that because of a simple touch, a simple stop, someone listening, that someone would not only come to know you in such a deep and personal way, but they would get connected to a church, our church or some other church in town, some place where they can grow, and then they can pass the love story on. And like a pebble dropped in a pond, the ripples would continue on, and we would all be storytellers, contributing to the great restoration of your kingdom. Father, thank you for my son. Thank you for the way he inspires me and models his love for you. Thank you for his willingness to stretch beyond what might be comfortable to come and speak from his heart. God, here we are. We are your children. Find us in a posture of humility as listeners. speak to us, guide us. In Jesus' name.